Coming up on today's show.
And he set the kid back down on his legs and he walked to the mother. She was tears streaming down her face. And I had to walk right past that as it was happening. And I said, man, this is real.
All of that and more on today's show.
Welcome to the program. I'm Reverend Steve Millar, and this is my wife, Kathy. And on today's program, we'll be discussing how Jesus Christ changes people's lives.
And today on the show, we have a lovely couple that have been married for over 50 years, and they're now a part of Grace Cathedral. We want to welcome you to the program, Jody and Dave.
Thank you very much.
Well, I guess we should start off by asking, how were you introduced to Grace Cathedral?
We actually came into Grace Cathedral by way of television. My grandmother in Indiana started watching the television program, The Ernest Angley Hour, and she actually got a miracle by watching the program. She laid her hands on the television screen, got healed of a bowel condition, and so she told my parents in Virginia about the miracle. She became a testifier right away. and so my parents started watching the program. And then they, in turn, in Virginia, told us in North Carolina about the program, so I started watching it. And then my parents were going to come to a crusade service in Winston-Salem where we were living. And so my daughter and I went with them to that crusade service.
Because Reverend Angley used to travel around the United States.
That's right. Crusade, yes. Many, many states all over the nation, as a matter of fact. So that was my introduction to Grace Cathedral. And then later on.
But you were married to Dave at the time.
I was married to Dave. Yes, we'd been married quite a few years at that point, about 12 years probably.
But it was just you and.
Yeah, we had one daughter at that point, Valerie. And David was a full-time worker.
That's correct. I actually worked for the government, and I could have gotten off to go to the crusade, but I was a rascal back then.
You chose not to.
I chose not to, yeah. I wasn't ready. Mm-hmm. But she was ready, and she became very much aware of things that I should be doing that I wasn't doing, that should be going to church somewhere.
Mm-hmm. I tried to find a local church in North Carolina to go to, but I couldn't find a place that had the power of God in it.
I also think a lot of times when you have a new family and a newborn child, a lot of times people all of a sudden want to get their lives straightened out, and they want to take their child, my child needs to grow up in church.
Right.
Absolutely.
And that's probably God was directing you to a church.
I was already going to church in Virginia when I was there and until the time I got married, and then we moved away to North Carolina. So I didn't have the church background at that point for mm-hmm. my children or my child at the point. So I did look for a church in North Carolina, but I couldn't find one that I was happy with. So the television program became my home church.
That's
Grace
wonderful.
Cathedral mm-hmm. was my home church. And then we moved with his job to Miami, Florida. There again, couldn't find a church. So I continued to watch Grace Cathedral's program.
Now this was what? 10, 20 years ago, or
That was
roughly?
Back in the late 70s.
Okay.
In the late 70s.
So it's been quite a while.
Quite a few years ago, yes.
And then when we went to Miami, things weren't too good at home between us. We had two more children while we were down there in a short time. And
So you had three children, and Dave was working.
Now.
Were you working at the time or no?
No.
Okay,
no,
so you were just staying at home.
I was at home,
serving the Lord,
to the children, praying a lot because in North Carolina, David was kind of a social drinker. He thought that was good times. I was not raised that way. I had a church background. He went to church, but it wasn't a full gospel church, and so. We had differing values, let's just say.
Yes, I was raised in some denominational churches, and I went from one to another, and it was sort of the dry gospel, if you will. And she being from Pentecostal background, it surprised me when I was dating her, certain things would go to church and there would be maybe a Holy Ghost message, something come forth. I said, what's that? She says, shh, I'll let you know later. She knew how to respond properly, not me not knowing. So later on, though, when things started deteriorating after we were married, if she wanted to go to church, I was okay to go to a denominational church.
Yeah.
And she, that wasn't for her.
Right.
And
I know.
And she was looking
with
for
us,
the Spirit. Yeah.
You know, I never was introduced to Pentecostal, and it's a lot to take in. When you go to a Pentecostal church, and you haven't been to one before, there's a lot going on that you're just
not familiar with.
You're not
at
familiar
all.
With. You just you're not used to seeing the Lord work that way and move in
and
a
by
church.
The same token, we tried the dry denominational churches, and I was not satisfied there.
Oh,
I thought,
much.
I might as well stay home and watch the program because there's nothing here. Mm-hmm. Why would I go to church for that?
Right.
There wasn't anything there to draw me.
Right.
So I stayed home and watched the Grace Cathedral programs.
And you got to see people being delivered and set free from sin, and that's what it's all about. That's
Absolutely.
Why Jesus came and died on the cross.
Right.
Right.
So that his blood could set us free from our sins.
Right.
And a lot of churches out there, they don't teach that. They teach once saved, always saved. You can do what you want and still make it into heaven.
Mm-hmm.
They don't teach that you must live free from sin.
Right.
That's right.
So then when we moved to Florida, David's social drinking kind of progressed, let's just say. I never allowed him to have beer or any alcohol at home. He tried it a few times and I just poured it out. And so he wasn't happy about that. That was just a waste of money. So he didn't continue doing that.
Waste of time too.
So he started going, well, I'll just go out with the guys for just a beer after work. That's all, just going to get one beer or something. And then it kind of progressed. It went more and more frequently. And to where it was all the time.
So you stood your ground.
Yes.
She did. And that sort of became a problem for us too, though, because what started out for me, and which is the way the enemy wanted it, it started out just one drink once a week, or maybe it was two drinks twice a week, and it just escalated to where it was five nights a week, maybe.
So in your mind, you're just thinking, oh, I'm okay, I can handle one drink,
exactly.
I can handle two, and...
It got to the point where I couldn't handle it, and yet it was still happening, and I was maybe working an evening shift and get off early, maybe 9 o'clock at night, and I might show up at home at 5 or 6 in the morning.
Wow.
It was that bad.
It started getting
over
really, really
and
bad.
Over, and it was a vicious cycle that I didn't realize was happening at first, but it was a progression that would just take you over. And I recall one night when it got so very bad, I tried to quit and I tried to stop, but I couldn't. And I was on my way home. It was probably 4:30, 4:45 in the morning, and I passed a church. I don't know what church it was, whatever, but I pulled over and I got out in the darkness and just fell on my knees in the parking lot and cried out to God. Please help me. Please help me. And that, I'm sure he heard it, of course.
Yes.
But then it came around later. But that's the kind of situation I was in. It was crying out to God to stop this.
Right. And Jody, like you said, you were just praying for him.
Yes, I was just home praying and just watching things fall apart around me. You know, I was in a strange state. I was away from my family.
Yes.
I didn't have anybody to call on except for God.
Mm-hmm.
And so I reached out to him. I was on my knees praying a lot. And things got so bad. We had two newborn children down in Florida. And he wasn't home to help with them. And it was just a struggle. It was a real struggle. And it got so bad that at one point that I did walk in on him. He was in the bedroom. He had a pistol in his hand. And I was not sure what he was going to do. And I'm not a in-your-face type of person. I said, what are you planning here? What are you thinking about doing? I didn't know if he was going to kill himself. I didn't know if he was going to kill us and then kill himself. Right. I didn't know what he was planning. And he just said, just leave. Just leave. So I just had to walk out of the room and leave it in God's hands and pray. Just pray. That's all I could do.
You trusted in the Lord in that situation, and it strikes me that a lot of, in the human, you would try to just give me that gun, you know, try to take it away from him. But what you did was just put it all in the hands of God. Yeah. You've been praying. Yeah. You have to trust it. When you pray, you have to trust God that he's going to work it out.
Yes.
And that's the reason you're praying.
Right. And in the meantime, I had been watching the television program, Grace Cathedral. And as I was watching it that day, the program said the Reverend was coming to Miami, Florida for a crusade service. And as it happened, and I know God had a hand in it, David walked into the room at the time and heard it. And he said, do you want to go?
Really?
Oh, my heart. I was sure.
Yes.
Sure.
What she didn't know at the time was earlier I had been that same weekend at the airport where I worked, and there was a handful of us went down to a lounge to have a beer, and somebody brought up the topic of God, and we talked a little bit about this and that, and they had each had a story, and I said, well, let me tell you my background, and I knew a little bit about the miracles that she had talked about and everything. So I had just talked to them, and they were like on the edge of their seat, and I thought, wow, that's amazing. People with drinks in their hands mm-hmm. are hungry for this. And so on the way home, I thought about it. It boggled my mind because people are searching. It hit me that people who are in my condition are searching. Mm-hmm. And then when I got home, I overheard the commercial that Reverend was coming for Miami Beach Convention Center Crusade. And I thought, I just was talking about this. This is beyond coincidence, I think. Do you want to go? And that he was working with me ahead of time to get me ready.
That's right. Mm-hmm.
Because that was totally foreign to her. That was mm-hmm. That wouldn't happen. But it was God all the way.
And so we went to that crusade service. And, of course, Reverend said, all of you that drink, and I don't mean Dr. Pepper, come on down here. So David went. To my surprise, David went down. Mm-hmm. And got his deliverance. Got his deliverance. And our lives totally, totally changed from that moment on.
What was going through your head when Reverend made that, you know, altar call? Did you just, like, get up, or were you thinking? What were your, do you remember?
There must have been 50 people went down in that same mm-hmm. call, and I was the very last one. I hesitated, mm-hmm. and I said, I better mm-hmm. go. I struggled a little bit with it, but when I went down, it was astonishing because, alcoholism, people go to these programs and everything here and there to try to help themselves, and those are good at what they can do. But this was, it was not a lifelong problem after that, because I went down and it was like shutting off a light switch. Mm-hmm. He laid hands on me and I'm on the floor. Oh, I didn't know what happened. And I picked myself up and he prayed the sinner's prayer with everybody. And then same thing, I'm out. And I was the last one getting up off the floor. And as I was getting off, walking by, I saw him praying for a woman's child that had never walked. He was probably 6 years old. And he set the kid back down on his legs and he walked to the mother. She was tears streaming down her face. And I had to walk right past that as it was happening. Mm-hmm. And I said, man, this is real.
It is real. Yes. It is real. Well, we have to take a quick break here, but we'll be right back with more wonderful things.
Coming up next.
I didn't have the desire for alcohol. It just left me instantly. And that was the big thing. There was no pull. There was no draw.
I have a miracle. I was delivered of heroin, cocaine, alcohol, tobacco over 4 years ago, and I'm still free today.
I have a miracle. I was healed 7 years ago of a lump in my breast. I have a miracle. I was healed of diabetes 18 years ago.
Are you unsure if miracles are real? Come to our Friday night miracle service, leaving your doubts and fears behind. For the Bible says, all things are possible to him that believeth. Come and God will meet you here.
This is that that was spoken by the prophet Joel in the last days. He said he would pour it out. He's pouring it out tonight. He's pouring it out tonight.
It's time now to receive the gift of the Holy Ghost.
Father, I call down this great anointing upon the people. Receive ye the Holy Ghost.
Hallelujah. We're back, and Dave, I want to hear more about your deliverance.
Well, it was phenomenal. It was so different. It was like having a new person living inside me. It was like I was totally different because I didn't have the desire for alcohol. It just left me instantly. And that was the big thing. There was no pull, there was no draw. It was because I had been delivered of those demon spirits that drew me to that.
Right.
And the Lord knew how to cut that off in a heartbeat, and he did exactly that.
And that's where I think people don't understand that when you get born again and set free, that the Lord can deliver you just like that. It doesn't
yes.
have to be a slow process where
right.
you go through withdrawals
no.
and all that. He just delivered you completely like you had never drank before.
Right. And mm-hmm. if people were drinking around me where I had to go through the airport and there's bars and stuff, there was no pull, no attraction whatsoever. It was gone. And I didn't have to be worried or concerned or go through some rehab program or anything like that. It was total deliverance, and it was instantaneous.
And Jody got to witness it.
I'm a living testimony that there was a life change right there. It changed his life, changed our lives.
Changed your family's life.
My children had a new daddy,
yeah,
you know, and it was so much better afterwards, and we could be happy again.
Right.
We hadn't had happiness since we were in Florida. But now it was back, you know, and God moved us around.
Well, first of all, about a year later, I heard that Reverend Ainsley was going to the Holy Land for a Holy Land tour. Mm-hmm. And I'd been seeking a Holy Ghost baptism. And I thought, well, okay, because she had the Holy Spirit baptism and I didn't. And so I went over there by myself with a tour group of about 500 people. And they told me that one night near the end of the tour, Reverend Ainsley would be taking the whole bunch of people, and there'd be those who's seeking the Holy Ghost. We had to have a Holy Ghost rally, and you could get the Holy Ghost. So he went room to room praying for people, and I was one of them. And I prayed. I went down again. It's about 8 o'clock in the evening, and I sought the Holy Ghost till right about midnight. And during that process...
Now, you said you went down again. What do you...
Well, when he mean? Laid hands
okay.
on you, sometimes you fall
slain?
Down.
Okay.
The slain in the Spirit.
Okay.
And the Holy Spirit was really moving for everybody. And I could tell there was a quivering on my lips, and that was unusual. And I would pray, and I would say hallelujah. We say glory or hallelujah. And it got to the point where it was starting to change, and I would lick my lips about 15 minutes, and I would pray, but it would lift. And then later on, I would lick my lips again, and it would lift. And I would have to pray about another 15 minutes, and I would lick my lips. And then I realized, I'm not going to lick my lips. I'm just going to keep praising no matter how dry I got. And that's when I got the Holy Ghost. And later on, I thought about this a lot, and in that brief moment, I was thinking more of David than I was the Lord.
Right. Mm-hmm.
And that was a little bit of self trying to creep in and hindering me. But that's when I got the Holy Ghost baptism. And shortly after that, they had a crusade down in Greensboro, North Carolina. And they said, "We're coming. You need to just come down to the crusade with us and help out." So sure enough, we did that once and brought the whole family down. And
that was his first ushering experience.
Yeah. And from that point on, I went to another crusade. We went, the whole family, we started traveling. Mm-hmm. So these, Reverend had these crusades all over the country. And I made sure to be able to get off work to go help out in this. And
so you were really changed.
Totally.
You were just 100% all in, helping Reverend Angely to take the gospel to the world.
Absolutely. Yes, we did.
Absolutely. And of course, it went from the States to different parts of the world later on.
Yes. Exactly. Later on, it was tremendous because we did things and we went places we never thought we would go to help other people experience what we had experienced.
That's right.
And traveling to the nations was an extraordinary experience in itself. I was able to later on take photos for the Holy Ghost magazine. And
you became Reverend's photographer.
Exactly. And I've taken a number of photos over the years, hundreds of thousands, I would say. But it's such an honor and a privilege because you get to see certain things of these miracles close up that other people haven't been able to see.
Did you have a photography background before that or no?
Actually, way back when I mentioned about it being in denominational churches, I was a photographer at Vacation Bible School.
Lord was preparing you back then.
I love it how God works it out and just, you know, people from all walks of life, all of a sudden they have a certain background and he just fits them into this puzzle of getting this gospel to the world.
He uses what he can in each individual's life to expand what he wants to later on if they will yield to it.
Right.
And that was the key to it. I enjoyed photography and I was taking pictures and getting good results, I thought, you know, but I never in my wildest dream imagined that I would be traveling around the world taking photographs all over the place, and particularly for some great and mighty wonders too, some miracles.
Yeah, you've captured a lot of images, a lot of manifestations of God's deliverance.
Yes.
And I know you have a very special picture of a man who you captured in one of the crusades that was really distressed and in sin, and then showed the before and after.
Yes, and I have those right there. This man was in Kigali, Rwanda crusade, and I was attempting to climb a platform to take a crowd shot, and I got up to the first level or so, only about maybe 10 feet in the air, and I normally don't do this to distract people. I try to wait till somebody's on stage singing, and I suddenly looked back and I saw Reverend Angely looking at me, I thought. So I just froze. I said, well, I'll wait till the song's over because I don't want to distract him. And so when the song finished, immediately he said, there's a man in the invalid section. There's a person in the invalid section and God wants you to know that he knows you are planning on committing suicide. And that's when I realized there was somebody right behind me, and I turned around and I looked, and sure enough, there was only one person reacting to this revelation. And he went further on to say, you have had a terrible, terrible life. And you've lost three people that's very, very close to your heart. They had been killed. And it was just driving this man to suicide. The devil was using that in his mind. And he said, you stay right there, don't go away. You need to give your heart to the Lord when I come down the invalid section. And later on, he did exactly that. But this man, I was in a position because God had stopped me right there to take these photos. If I'd been on the ground, I wouldn't take it because it was intrusive. But if I'd been higher up to take the crowd shot, I'd be too high to get what I got. But on his face, if you could look at those photos there, you can see the distress. First, he was bowed over with his hand on his head. Mm-hmm. And then as he slowly started raising up, you could see the despondency, the desperation that was in this man's face. And the Lord went on to say, you have a gun at home. You're planning to shoot yourself. He was very detailed and he knew it was him. Mm-hmm. And this man, I found out later on, his name was Jerome. And the photographs I got from him just show the condition that somebody is so oppressed in their mind about. And you can see it. And then I've got photographs of him afterwards. Mm-hmm. And you can see the transformation, what one person...
It's an amazing transformation.
It's night and day.
You can't even tell it's the same person.
No, it's
just
astonishing.
Amazing.
The before and after.
Yeah.
Just like David's life,
yes.
Before and after.
And that's when you were saying about the gun, it just took me back to what Jody was saying about,
exactly.
you sitting in there, I think you said your bedroom or wherever, and you're contemplating what you were going to do.
Right.
Yeah.
And, I think the big thing today is that people need to realize that God can change people's lives. They just have to be
yielded. Give them a chance.
Yes.
Give them a chance.
Yes. So this was a wonderful program. At this time, though, I'd like to pray and ask anybody if they would like to ask Jesus in their heart to pray with me. Say, oh God, save my soul. Forgive me for my sins. But I have come home to serve you the rest of my life. And I believe that the blood of Jesus washes away all of my sins. Come into my heart, Jesus. Come on in, Jesus. Friend, if you said that prayer, you have Jesus Christ in your heart. Let Him change your life today. You are a new creature in Christ. You see how God changed Dave's life? He can change yours. God bless you, and we'll be right back.
Like receiving special gifts? I know, that's a silly question. Did you know Jesus offers an eternal and supernatural gift to each of His followers that helps us face life every day? And that gift is the Holy Ghost. Maybe you think the Holy Ghost is a fairy tale, or He just doesn't fit into your fast-paced world, or maybe you just don't care. But how can we deny the tongue of fire and the heavenly dove? Why don't you come to the Worship Center at our website and learn about this supernatural gift? You owe it to yourself.
If you are enjoying today's program, let us know by sending in a donation. Your gift of love will enable others to be lifted up into the grace of God.
And I hope this program blessed you as much as it blessed us. The Bible says that Jesus Christ is the same yesterday, today, and forever. That means the same Jesus that performed miracles more than 2,000 years ago is performing them today.
Yes, and if you need a miracle or a deliverance, just like David received his deliverance from alcoholism, you can have your deliverance. Come to our Friday night service and receive prayer. God bless you. We hope to see you there. Bye-bye.
If this program has blessed you today, let us know on our Facebook page. You're also invited to attend any of our services. Come and witness the wonderful things of heaven for yourself. This program has been made possible by the friends and partners of Ernest Angley Ministries.